Speaker, our keynote, our closing keynote for the conference. It's not usually you have keynotes at the beginning of a conference, and we did, of course. But to have a closing keynote is a very special occasion that's really warranted by the nature of this conference and the person who is willing to accept that assignment. And that person is Carolyn Woo. So Carolyn, as you know, is the President and CEO of Catholic Relief Services, a post that she's held since January of 2012. She spent the 15 years prior to that as our dean in the Mendoza College of Business. During that time, she helped enable the College of Business to move from being unknown to being a top-ranked business school. Under her tenure, our undergraduate program, for example, was ranked number one, and that legacy continues with Dean Wong. Carolyn was the first female dean to head our accreditation body, AACSB, has done a remarkable job, and with the UN Global Compact, was the architect of the Principles for Responsible Management Education that many business schools now belong to. I would just end with saying that, personally speaking, Carolyn, I am just so happy that you're here. Carolyn Woo is the best boss I ever had. Please welcome Carolyn Woo.
I just want to say what a wonderfully inspiring experience I had. I just came in around lunchtime, sat with our younger people, they're not young people. Presentation just now, such energy, passion, creative solutions. I sat there and I thought, everybody at Notre Dame, particularly the deans and the provost, should have been here to understand what we could do with our curriculum and what we need to do to inspire our young people in terms of the work that can be done. Before I go too far, I really want to thank a number of people. First of all, for Leo Burke and Frank Incropera, because both of them were my teachers on this topic. I think I'm just like most people, or probably worse than most people. I would say 10, 12, 13 years ago, I knew climate was an issue, but I really didn't turn my attention to it. But Frank Incropera, his passion for this, his scholarship on this, and Leo Burke, I mean, is not only passion, I think he devotes his life in seeking the type of solutions. So those two were my teachers. They inspired me. And also to prove a point, a lot of times we are inspired and we learn from others. And that is about 12 years ago, I was about to turn 50 and I was looking for a new car. And I'm not really a car person, but somehow I thought I needed a sports car for no good reason at all. And one of my colleagues, Bob Bretz, drove a Prius. And because he drove a Prius, he talked to me and I ended up celebrating my 50th birthday with a Prius. And I think that's how important our actions are to each other in terms of being teachers. They say adults actually learn from others. So I'm your closing person. I'm actually shortening my speech a little bit because you are just probably all woolly-headed at this point. There's so much information, such rich information. So I think that I'm going to just try to sort of like be the ending, kind of like what is the message to take away? You heard a lot. You heard from the science perspective, the industry perspective, the policy perspective, our young entrepreneur perspective. I'm going to start off with the faith perspective just because I love Pope Francis. I was at the Vatican during the launch of Laudato Si'. There's this thing in me that, I just do not want to let this man down. And I'm going to start from there. But what I'm going to do actually is open up with about a five-minute video about Laudato Si'. So I'd like to have my colleague John bring up this little video.
Come è stato annunciato, giovedì prossimo sarà pubblicata una lettera enciclica sulla cura del creato. Invito ad accompagnare questo avvenimento con una rinnovata attenzione alle situazioni di degrado ambientale, ma anche di recupero nei propri territori. Questa enciclica è rivolta a tutti. Preghiamo perché tutti possano ricevere il suo messaggio e crescere nella responsabilità verso la casa comune che Dio ci ha affidato a tutti.
Laudate si, o mi Signore, laudate si, o mi Signore, laudate si, o mi Signore, laudate si, o mi Signore. Laudate si comes from the music of the heart, music of the human heart. It comes from the music of nature, singing praise to God. It comes from an effort, an attempt to give a new hope to the world, a new sign that we are all related, we are all responsible one for the other. Laudate si comes from the voice and the heart of God. It's God's song that sings through creation. It's God's song that sings through each of us. Laudate si is an expression of responsibility. It tells us that I no longer can live my life for myself. My life is a mission, as Pope Francis tells us. My life is to give glory to God by respecting and caring and promoting a sense of being in this together. That life it's one, and that we're all members. Each of us bring a special contribution. So it's not just a flowery song about how we should live with nature. It's challenging us to revise our entire way of living our lives, how we internalize the values of the gospel of our Christian lives, and what challenges this means for us. If someone is starving somewhere in the world, we are responsible. If someone doesn't have enough food to eat, then we need to reduce and review the way that we approach food, the way we approach our use of goods, the way we accumulate things, the way we expend and discard things. We need to be challenged to review, to conduct a conversion of our own lives. Nature is barking. Nature is chasing after us, telling us we've got to wake up. It's disturbing us. But it's not disturbing us in order to threaten our lives. It's telling us we are already a threat to ourselves. We're a threat to the world. And nature is trying to tell us, step back from the brink before it's too late. What happens in exploitation without limitation is not only is nature stripped of its dignity, which God gave it, and we cannot deny that, but we are progressively stripped of our own dignity, because each time that we fail to show dignity toward other human beings and toward nature, we lose our own dignity. We lose our own recognition of our special character, if you will, that God has given to us as human beings, that we are called to be this mission, to be this witness in a particular way. Laudate si, o mi Signore, 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 laudate si.
So this is the genius of Pope Francis and those who helped him, who named this encyclical Laudato Si, a song to God, praised be. By the way, that's Father Michael Perry, the head of the Minister General of the Franciscans OFM, an Indianapolis boy who wanted to be a lawyer, who played in a folk group at church and eventually became the head of the Franciscans with spike hair and rides a motorcycle. So I think that you should bring him in sometimes, but just, you know, see the joy and but also the concern, but ultimately the sense of God. Praised be. I was just last week very busy. The Pope was around. There were lots of things at the United Nations. And one of the people who spoke was Cardinal Tagle from the Philippines, a place which has been probably just badgered with natural storms and so on. And Cardinal Tagle asked the question, what is there to praise? And he cited, he said, one of the worst experiences that he ever had was to preside over the funeral of two little children who died after they ate the chicken that their father retrieved from the garbage. And he said, what type of world is it that food becomes trash and becomes somebody else's food? So this is the world that we are in. But yet we can see from this, the Pope reminds us, praise be to God. There is a song of God, and that song is still being sung, but we have to listen to it and we have to honor that song. Clearly that came from the Canticle of Creatures. Sometimes you call it Canticle of the Sun by St. Francis. You would remember Brother Sun, Sister Moon, Mother Earth. A reminder that Earth is our common home. We breathe its air. We are made of its elements. And it's, of course, praise be to the creation of God. So there is that. But there's also the flip side of praise be, not just praising God for his creation, but how will we make of our life a song of praise? When we utter the word, praise be to God, we are also expected to praise God with our own life, to return thanks and return blessings, to acknowledge what we have received from this garden. And so, by the way, I'm only going to make 10 points. So the second point is that praise be is not just for the creation of God. Praise be is what will we do in our own way of giving thanks. Clearly, we have not done a very good job. The third point is, and to make it very briefly, I know you cover all of this, Cardinal Turkson, whose Pontifical Council helped develop this encyclical, he just used this word. He said, we are turning God's garden into a wasteland. And he's not saying it. The Pope is not just saying it out of just a sense of feelings or just casual observations. It's developed from science. The Pontifical Academy of Sciences has hosted many, many, many workshops on this topic and invited the very best people around the world. And so the evidence is not just casual evidence, but it's scientific evidence. In fact, at one point, there were American politicians on the first day of the launch of the encyclical who says, what does the Pope know about climate? Well, only to find out that the Pope was a chemistry major, and his first job was in the chemistry lab. But anyway, they dropped that. In fact, the Pope actually said, science is the best tool to help us listen to the cry of the earth. Okay? So that's my third point. My fourth point is that Michael Perry said this is a song. And I think that the whole Laudato Si, I don't know how many of you have read it. It's not really that long, even though they say it's 192 pages. It goes pretty quickly. I actually think of it as a love story. It's the Pope's love story. Granted, it sounds a bit like a country love song. You know how country love song goes? I give you my heart and you spurned it. I gave you my love and you gave it to somebody else. I gave you my best work and you spat on it and you tore it apart. I saw the best in you and you forgot who you were. Right? That's what the encyclical really is saying. It's about love, it's about heart, it's about God's best creation, it's about who we are meant to be at our very best, which for whatever reasons, out of fear, out of the lack of security, we forget it. And like any love story, my fourth point is that it's built around three things. It's built around relationships, built around responsibility, and the third one is action. And in fact, there was a bishop I talked to, he said, oh, I understand the encyclical, it's about relationships. And in fact, this is not a scientific working paper, it's not a technical encyclical, even though it cites science, but it returns us back to the sources of what leads us to where we are today. What are the root causes? What is the behavior? And where is the breakdown that leads us to where we are today? So the Pope opened up with the whole sense of relationships, that everything, all of our life, everything in earth is bounded together. We are designed that way. We have to rely on each other. We are interdependent on each other. Our faiths are joined together. We are supposed to nourish and be nourished by each other. This is a system where there's no buffer. You know, unless you put really artificial temporary buffers, there are no real buffers. We are designed to be all integrated together. And in particular, there are three relationships that matter. And it is our relationship with God, our relationship with neighbors, and our relationship with creation. Whatever we do to one, we do to the others. And I don't want to go into the whole encyclical, but one very poignant and memorable point that the Pope made was that in a throwaway cultures, you may start with throwing away things, but eventually you will throw away people. And that's why he reaches out to the elderly. He always calls for attention to them. He reaches out to the disabled because they are really discarded in society. Those who are in prison, right? They're the dregs of the earth. The poorest people on earth. Those are the people, he said, we have to really put our arms around because in a throwaway culture, we throw away people. We don't only just throw away people, we throw away, of course, a lot of God's creation in terms of biodiversity. The Pope reminds us that if we look at everything from the standpoint of whether it has value to us, whether it helps us make a living or make more money, we begin to put a value on species and flora and fauna and so on, and we deem them inconvenient. Sometimes we just burn them, sometimes carelessly we discard of those, but he reminded us that everything has a purpose and really is God's creation, is not ours. And so that's why he said, if you look at the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor, they are not two separate phenomena. They are one phenomenon. They are caused by the same things. Whatever damage we do to the environment, it will come back to us. However, unfortunately, the most burden falls on the poorest of the earth. In my work, those are the people I see all the time. There is an estimation that the people who will be most affected, I think all of us will be affected, but the people who are most affected, there are 3 billion people in the least developed countries and in island states who will suffer the most. Let me just give you a little indicator. Because of erratic rainfall pattern, because of drought, Ethiopia this year did not get its short rains and its long rains. These are these terms. One takes place in the spring, one just concluded. It did not get the rain it needed. And so this country will likely move from 15 million people with food insecurity issue to closer to 40 million people. This is just one country, one rainfall season. And there will be 40 million people who will have issue with food insecurity. There is an estimate that the smallest farmers, what we call smallholder farmers and fishers, 80% of them will be affected because they make a living from the land. They depend very much on rainfall patterns. They are affected by storms, droughts, floods, pests. And what they lose is not one season of crops. Usually they borrow money, which comes at an interest rate of 12% a month. If they could not recover their seeds or their chemical costs, they would go under. In a lot of the island states, we are talking about people's livelihoods, people's homes, people's lives, sometimes people's culture, people's heritage being destroyed. We're talking about 3 billion of the poorest people. And it becomes a justice issue because these 3 billion people ask, we weren't responsible and never enjoyed the lifestyle that created these problems. That's the justice issue. And so when the Pope says the cry of the earth is the cry of the poor, and the cry of the poor is Christ's cry because he located himself in them. I'd just like to give you a little example that I had. And, you know, I left Notre Dame about 3.5 years ago, and I have had to open my eyes to a lot of abuses that, you know, being a dean of a business school, I never realized. One example was, again, in Ethiopia. I was going through the a flower farm. This is owned by a very large multinational company in Europe. It's enclosed in plastic. It's just like huge, long rows of these greenhouses, which are covered with plastics. And it grows a lot of flowers, which are for export. So for example, from the consumer end, I love to buy those flowers. I remember when I was young, it cost like $3 for a long stem rose, like in the 70s. Those of you who have bought flowers, remember? A wonderful long stem rose, $3. Nowadays, you can buy a bundle of 20 long stem roses for $15 at a big box. Much reduced, right? I mean, a dollar a piece or less, from $3 a piece. Well, I saw where it came from. And so in this Ethiopian flower farm, the ventilation was so poor because nobody bothered to invest in ventilation for these workers who have no say. And there were no regulations in terms of when they could take their breaks or how concentrated the air is, that these individuals develop a much higher rate of cancer, of being enclosed in these hot environments with chemicals in the air. In addition to that, there was also the draw on water. You could imagine what that would be like, to the point that the water table offers nothing for the local farmers who have to depend on agriculture. And because they cannot get a good crops, it is their wives and their daughters who are working in these flower farms. And from then on, I couldn't bring myself to buy cheap flowers from big boxes. I made my husband grow them. But other than that, you know, it's a recognition of sort of like, do we know really what is happening in terms of workers and in terms of the environment, in terms of people's rights? Not to mention now seeing a lot of situations involved in mining, where people lose their land rights, where there's pollution of toxins, which again can create cancer, which goes through the water runoff into people's soil so that they can't grow crops anymore. They have to depend on mining. So here is really, again, the cry of the earth, the cry of the poor, the cry of God, all of these coming together. The sixth point I want to make is what is made by the Pope, and that is, what is our responsibility? Very early on in Laudato Si, he asked, what type of world do we want, and particularly for our children who are growing up? What is our purpose? What is the meaning of our work and our efforts? In Genesis, we were given the land to till and to keep. We did a lot of tilling. We didn't do much keeping. And so that gets to the seventh point related to actions. And my actions are really targeted at business, a business audience, our business students. First of all, everybody asked me, does the Pope reject business as a solution? And I just want to say, recovering from some of the teachings, even in Evangelii Gaudium and in his recent comments to Congress, he actually said, business is a vocation. In Laudato Si, he said, business actually has a noble role when it creates meaningful employment for others. In Santissimus Annus, written by Pope Paul, John Paul II, it says markets, and you know, he fought communism. He said, markets is a tool for us to really express our creativity, for us to get work that builds up our dignity. But the danger is, how do you accumulate that wealth, and what do you do with that wealth, and whether you identify yourself with that wealth? Pope Benedict reminds us in Caritas in Veritate that it's not business itself, but it's the ethical energies that we bring to it or fail to bring to it. He actually also reminded us that charity is not an interpersonal issue. It is, but it's more than that. That charity is also an institutional issue, which means our institutions in society, whether that is government or business, also has the responsibility to make sure that people are treated correctly. So I want to say, the Pope is not against business, but the Pope is certainly against the abuses of business, and he has seen plenty of those. Having grown up in Argentina, going through the currency crisis around the year 2000, being in Europe, looking at what the financial crisis of 2008 did to Europe, for example, he has plenty to say about those abuses. He is, of course, against unethical, predatory practices, which we saw in the financial crisis. He is against unlimited growth, because that growth is not sustainable, and because that growth induces people to consume, and that consumption leads to waste. So this type of artificial growth. He is against economic development, which only benefits the rich and leave the people at the bottom out of that equation. And we see that too. I was recently involved in an impact investing conversation about a wonderful social business in Peru that works with farmers to increase their productivity and to teach them how to grow the right thing in the right way and handle them in the right manner. It was a great business, but the business centered around that person buying up the farmland and having farmers work for him. And that's how he would teach them in terms of what is a better way to farm. And we looked at this and we say, we don't believe in big farms becoming bigger and then small farmers losing their land titles. We were in several of these situations, actually. I was reviewing a proposal, actually, for a competition. And it was about using ethanol as a source of fuel. And this is in Haiti, and the benefits associated with it, except that all of the ethanol comes from one farm that is owned by one very wealthy family. Haiti is owned by 12 very wealthy families. And so when we look at this proposal, we said, no, this is not the way we want development to take place, because it excludes the people who are at the bottom. So the Pope is against that. Above all, the Pope is against idolatry, which is putting profits ahead of people. And so he is against the exploitations and the abuses of business rather than business itself. But of course, I think that he is so filled with images and the reality of some of these bad practices, which is really where Europe is about, is still trying to recover from that period. But otherwise, he reminds us that business can be a noble vocation, but it depends on whether we could do it or not. I actually had a series of examples then about how business can play a really excellent role. In fact, I think that climate smart is generally business smart. In fact, we just heard a whole panel who gave us those illustrations and examples. I want to add one more to what I think one of our panelists was talking about too, and that is, if you look at energy use and economic growth, we usually think that economic growth is not possible without more energy use, and Germany just proved us wrong. Germany enjoyed growth without the same percentage of growth in energy consumption, all right? So there are different ways, but I think that a climate smart is energy smart. So a couple, let me just give three sources that you could go plow and dig and so on. By the way, a lot of times we focus on what is not working, what government allocation that didn't come through, who is blocking what, and I'll give you another example later on. I think we focus a lot on what is not happening and what came to a block. I think we need to focus a lot more on what is happening, as I think our panelists did. One of these initiatives that I really often go to as a source of inspiration is an initiative in office started by the European Union, actually. And it was started around 2008. It's called the Eco Innovation Office of the European Union. And it's just great fun. The whole idea is, what are the innovations which are eco, right, friendly, whether it's more efficient energy use, more renewables, and so on. On that website, it has over 40 industry sectors, everything you could think of, including a sector which is called extraterrestrial. So I didn't know what that was. I never visited them. But it has services, it has furniture, it has apparel, it has manufacturing, it has waste. It has 40 different sectors with hundreds and hundreds of cases of eco innovation. It's actually inducing inventiveness and innovations at the grassroots level across all sector to think about energy, you know, as a primary variable. All right, so how exciting is that? Not only that, it actually has a scorecard for the different member states of the European Union. And that scorecard is based on 16 variables, you know, eco inputs, eco activities, eco output, job creation, and so on. All right? So it really tracks these things. It has a fund, and it's not a very large fund. The first 3 years, from the year 2008 to 2011, this fund, I think I'm looking for my, you know, is 126 projects with 86 million euros. So you could submit your business plan and apply for one of these funds. As you can tell, 86 million euros for 126 projects is about 670,000 euros per project. So not very large. And so it went through the first 3 years of implementation. It funded for 3 years. And then they tried to estimate the effect 2 years after and 5 years after. Just to give you some sense, by the way, the majority of these projects are small and medium enterprises. There were only 7 large corporation projects. Usually requires 4 partners, involve 4 partners, and usually cross-country barriers, which is not hard in Europe. Some of the results, the water savings of these projects for the first 3 years were equivalent to reducing the use by 350,000 people. The waste and consumption was equivalent to what is generated by 125,000 people. A big estimate, which is the damage and avoidance costs, which is like health problems, asthma, you know, other things, that type of climate-induced problems, 840 million euros after 5 years, generated 1,000 jobs. The reason I like this, because it's about grassroots. It's not some top-down something. And it's pervasive. It's not like, oh, we only have this in transportation. We only have this in housing. But we have it across the board. is a way to induce people to think differently, to design differently, to create business models which are different, to allow this to become a social movement. And I usually like to share that with students because I think we have a lot of budding entrepreneurs, and I think that that is a great source of inspiration. The second site that I would recommend is really the Principles for Responsible Investments. Some of you who work with the UN Global Compact knows about this. It's a spin-off now which focuses only on asset and investment managers. It has 1,380 signatories. These signatories are asset managers, asset owners, portfolio managers, and so on, representing $59 trillion of assets, right? So this is a big group. They operate around six principles, and they are related to environment, society, and governance. It is now pushing for a different level of fiduciary duties, understanding that fiduciary duties actually have to be long-term, and they actually said multi-generational in nature. What that means is that they're also pushing for reporting the carbon emissions of portfolios, not just individual companies, but portfolios. So they have some room. How do you want to comprise your portfolio? And so you could set the target for that portfolio should have. You could compare best practices, but it's at the portfolio level, which really requires it to also have a measurement at the individual company level. It is calling for multiple approaches. Divestment is one of them, but engagement is also another one of those. There are active shareholders who are not just calling for carbon measurement and carbon reduction, but calling for the return of cash rather than the reinvestment in more fossil fuel activities. You can go that direction. So there's engagement. There's, of course, also investment. It's not enough just to divest. Is where you put the money toward. So that's another area. I mean, just to see that large number of investment managers, which are global, who represent a very big chunk, $59 trillion is not a small change here. And so I'm always encouraged by that. The third part, of course, I don't know whether you've seen some of the latest estimates that are coming up from the World Bank and from various energy commissions, something which is called the Clean Trillion. And that is the whole idea that the world would need about $1 trillion of investment in order to bring us to our carbon targets of 2%. And that it needs to be an investment over 44 years, like $1 trillion per year over 40-some years to take us to 2050. Sounds like a huge number, $1 trillion. I actually don't think you really need $1 trillion. People just have these huge, big estimates. I think once we start going, I think there's actually, you could tip the point, you know, tipping point at a certain point, because it allows a lot of activities to get going. I think several hundred billions would be great to get to that point. But just to give some sense of what $1 trillion means, it means about 1.3% of the global GDP. And actually, there's a lot of money sitting on the side. As we all know, corporations are very rich with cash, right? Money is finding a place to go. In addition, we have not looked at the benefits. We've only looked at the costs and the investments. So $1 trillion is about 1.3% of the global GDP. And just to give you a comparison, our insurance premium losses and so on amount to 3% of global GDP. So we choose to buy insurance, and we can actually probably lower insurance and lower our risk at the same time. But of course, all of these things too changes the risk and return of assets. And so there's a need to recalculate almost all of those. My ninth point now, you probably don't know, but I'm to my ninth point is, I want to share a couple of really inspiring encounters I had. And again, it's sort of about things and blockages and obstacles which we focus on, and it discourages us. But I'll give you two examples. I was just visiting with Senator Susie Collins. She calls herself Susie, introduces herself as Susie Collins, Republican, from New Hampshire. She is one of the few Republicans who is a very staunch supporter for climate action. And I visit them because the U.S. Catholic Church and CRS, as a part of it, is advocating for mitigation policies and adaptation policies. And so we go visit different politicians. When I visited with her, it was just 2 days ago, Monday. You know, these visits are very short. They're very busy people. And I thank her. I said, Senator Collins, thank you for making possible, you know, this $500 million that the U.S. government will contribute to the Green Climate Fund. And the U.S. had made a commitment of $3 billion over 4 years towards this fund. It's a global fund. So $500 million is not quite 25% of $3 billion. But in any case, $500 million is a lot of money. She was the deciding vote to make sure that the money is allocated, 50% against, 50% for, and she was the deciding vote. So I said, do you think that this will happen again next year, that every year we'll go up for a vote to try to get these hundreds of millions of dollars? And she looked at me and she said, Carolyn, the prognosis is not good for this money. And she said, I don't have any confidence that next year we will get it. Okay, she said, I know this is not what you want to hear, but that is the reality. Okay, so I said, how about the cap and trade? She said, dead. It's dead. She said, it's a 2,000-page document. There are so many, you know, bells and whistles and gift backs and horse trades and so on. She said, it's gotten to the point that I can't even vote for it. She said, it's dead. Wow, you know, not very good. But she said, we should never give up. She said, let me tell you what I'm doing. She said, there are ways to sort of keep moving the engine forward. And one of those, one of the bills that she has co-sponsored with Senator Murphy, who is a Democrat, and she does these bipartisan bills, is on super pollutants. So it's about soot, methane, and aerosols. And she said, and it's apparently 100 to 300 times more damaging than carbon dioxide. She said, we are pushing for super pollutants because people may not fight super pollutants as the bill. And then she looked at me, she said, yeah, we're also trying to recover another bill. We have, you know, let it settle. You know, we're going to, you know, bring it back from the dust. And there's another bill co-sponsored with, I think, Senator Dick Durbin, and it's on clean cook stove. You know, she said, do you know clean cook stoves in the developing countries represent about 17% of emissions, all right? And soot is very damaging. And she said, that's your clientele, the very poor people. They're the people who use those cook stoves, and it's very damaging to their lungs. I want to share this because I walk away, and I don't know whether I felt good or didn't feel good. You know, I mean, but then I said, look, Carolyn, you have to be realistic. Do you really anticipate that the government could deal with something as complex as cap and trade, really? But the fact is that one of our congressional leaders is not giving up. And I think that gives us sort of a reminder, we don't have permission to give up. We just have to try different ways. And another person who is very inspiring to me is an Episcopalian senator from Rhode Island. Senator Whitehouse, a Democrat. He is very much for climate. But you know what he has done? When we visited with him, let's just say 2 months ago now, he said that for 107 sessions where he addressed, you know, these sessions, Each one of those 107 times, he has talked about climate. Now, I don't know whether the chamber is empty or only his own staff is there or only Democrats are there, but you have to sort of like recognize the spirit of someone who's just not giving up. And when the Pope released his speeches, he immediately wrote his reflection on sort of like, what does it mean to him? So I know we don't give a lot of credit to politicians. We're a bit jaded in that way. But I have to say, I walk away and say nobody has the permission to give up. My 10th point really come back to, and then I'm going to show a little video. The Pope in Laudato Si asked for ecological conversion. Now, we have to each decide for ourselves what that conversion means. But for me, I think it means three things. It's so easy for each of us, perhaps not the people in this room, to feel like there's not a problem, right? There's no problem. Or it is not my problem. Or there's nothing I can do about it. And I think that conversion is really saying, there's a problem, and it is my problem. And yes, there is something you can do about it. So I just want to end, and I think that this conference has been just so inspiring because you're actually listening to real examples of people doing. I am not naive. I know the obstacles in front of us. But we can't give up. By the way, one of the things that CRS is going to do is we've been very active in the advocacy for this is because in the field, we are encountering people who are suffering because of these consequences. We are looking at different parts of the world, Central America, Africa. In Central America, to look at what a 2 degrees change, how would that affect maize and corn? In terms of the productivity, what are the mitigating actions we could take? In Africa, we are working on climate smart agriculture and so on. So we actually encounter the suffering and try to get ready in some ways for the consequences that would come. So I just want to say, just keep working on it. There is a tipping point if everybody works hard enough at it. If you sometimes say nothing is happening, go to some of these websites and see how you could become a part of it. I'm going to end with a little video, again, for 5 minutes, and we talk about that Laudato Si is a love story, and this is the love story as articulated by an old friend. I think we all miss him a bit, Carl Sagan. Thank you, John.
From this distant vantage point, the Earth might not seem of any particular interest. But for us, it's different. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering, thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines, every hunter and forager, every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there on a mote of dust suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors, so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings. How eager they are to kill one another. How fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known.
For all of our follies, all of our mistakes, let we cover the best of ourselves to take care of this planet. Thank
you. Thank you, Carolyn. What a fitting way to end. And your notion that no one has permission to give up. And so the road is long, and however long that is. We have here, as some of you would know who watch Notre Dame football, that at football games, at commercials, there are these special infomercials on the university asking, what would you fight for? And so that's the question with which we leave here after hearing about the complexities, the many dimensions, the challenges, the opportunities. What would you fight for? Really? Let's each ask ourselves that. And lastly, never forget, go Irish! Thank you. Thanks to all of our speakers and panelists, and thanks for our learning community that's been just so outstanding at this conference. Thank you very much. Safe travels.